you pray with me? We thank thee, O God, for the gift of thy love, and we offer and present unto thee, so far as we are able, all that we are, all that we have, and all that we do, as only an emptiness to be filled by thee until thou art all in all and we are complete, through the one who is the very fullness of thy love, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I still have a hard time going back into the right one language and will give responses that are like right one and a half, you know, somewhere between the right one and right two responses. Our gospel lesson today is part of a larger passage, so a little background to put it into context might be helpful. Jesus and his disciples are in the suburbs of Caesarea Philippi, the city which is located way up north near the grotto that has a spring that is the source of the Jordan River. From there, the Jordan River flows south into the Sea of Galilee and south again into the Dead Sea. So at the source of the Jordan River is the city of Caesarea Philippi, previously known as Panaeus or Panaeus, named after Pan, the Greek god of nature, flocks, shepherds, the one who frolics with his woodland companions, the nymphs. There, in this place, Herod the Great had built a temple dedicated to the Emperor Augustus of Rome as a deity, and the goddess Roma, who was the deity personification of the city of Rome. You get the picture. Jesus and his disciples are at this pagan deity central religious shrine, at where he asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And as we know, after the other disciples make wrong guesses, Peter gets the answer right by responding, "You're the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one of God." And Jesus sternly orders them to tell no one about him. And then comes the verses of our lesson. It's a part of the same event. So Jesus begins to teach his followers that he must undergo great suffering, be rejected by all the religious authorities, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. My point is that just as soon as they realize that Jesus is the Messiah, he immediately begins telling them about the costliness of his mission. He disabuses them of the popular idea at the time that the Messiah would come and overthrow the Roman pagan oppressors. Indeed, he tells them that the Messiah is to be the suffering servant of God and will die at the hand of the rulers of the earth in order to be raised again. Well, this news shocked the disciples to their core. Why is it shocking, you ask? We stand with 2,000 years of knowing this greatest of all stories, but the disciples did not have our advantage. It was a scandalous idea to them that the anointed one of God would not simply come in and overthrow the Roman oppressors like Rambo, but rather would die at their hands. It was an unthinkable thing to tell these faithful Jewish folks whose country was occupied by pagan Romans, good folks who had seen their country pillaged and plundered by foreign soldiers, folks who had been forced to pay huge taxes at the hands of criminal foreign extortionists, folks who had been waiting for years for the Messiah to come and overthrow these invaders. It was an outrage to them to say that the Messiah would not overthrow the Romans. You see, the Bible is full of politics. It's just not our politics, so we don't think about it as politics, but this was political in those days. It's no wonder that Peter took Jesus aside and tried to set him straight. Peter uses the Greek language equivalent of telling Jesus to shut up. He privately dressed down God in the flesh. But then Jesus reprimanded Peter just as harshly. And instead of doing it privately, he does it in front of the other disciples. He used this moment as a teaching opportunity. And he uses some of the harshest words ever to come out of Jesus' mouth. "Get behind me, Satan." Now the word Satan means tempter. So let's try this. "Get behind me, you tempter." For Peter was trying to tempt Jesus into avoiding everything he was going to have to go through. He was trying to tempt Jesus into avoiding the agony in the garden, into avoiding the kangaroo court trial, into avoiding the beating and scourging, into avoiding the suffering, into avoiding the nails in his hands and feet, into avoiding the piercing of his side. Who would not want to avoid that? And Peter is tempting Jesus just like Satan did for the 40 days in the wilderness. "Get behind me, Satan," Jesus says, "for you are setting your mind on human things, not on divine things." For Peter wants the easy way out. Peter wants the glory without the price. Peter wants to remake God's plan in Peter's image instead of the other way around. Peter wants Jesus to conform to his expectations, but Jesus doesn't conform to Peter's expectations. Which brings me to the question that I often ask myself. When we pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," do we really mean it? Do we really mean that we're willing to change all of our own notions and thoughts and desires in order to conform them to the will of God? Or like Peter, do we want God to conform to our will and just simply bless what we want? Notice that as soon as Jesus tells his disciples the terrible truth, Peter reprimands him. It's simply too horrible a thought for Peter to deal with. So Peter jumps into immediate denial. We humans simply cannot comprehend the depth of God's sacrifice, so we try to run away from it. We try to avoid the horrible cost of salvation. And Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not on the side of God, but on the side of man." The point is this. Jesus chooses the path that will lead to his death. Jesus came for the express purpose of dying for our sins. The unthinkably horrible cost of grace was the price God was willing to pay. And likewise, Jesus tells us, if we are to follow him as our Lord, we must be willing to take up and bear our own crosses. Think about that in a more modern context. Think about Jesus saying, "Take up your electric chair and follow me. Take up your gas chamber and follow me. Take up your firing squad and follow me." We talk all the time about people having their crosses to bear. We talk about our chronic illnesses as being our crosses to bear, about all the misfortunes of life being crosses to bear. But those are not what Jesus is talking about. Those are things that we don't choose, but rather just are thrust upon us. Jesus says, if anyone would come the way I have come, let him deny himself, his own interest, and take up his cross. Pick it up and follow me. Taking up our crosses is not about things that we cannot control. It's about choosing to take on hardships that we could avoid if we wanted to. It's the making of the choice of sacrifice, pure and simple. It is choosing to do something we'd really rather not do. Willing and chosen sacrifices, large and small. And to deny that everything we choose to do has a price to pay denies the cost of discipleship. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me, Jesus says. The idea of taking up a cross is the idea behind giving up something for Lent. The idea is to deny yourself something so that you can help somebody else. I was joking with a friend of mine. I am such a not sacrificial person, it's pitiful. I was joking with a friend of mine that the thing I gave up for Lent was a slice of lime in my gin and tonic. Because you have to give up something. Sacrifice is important, you know. I was really mocking myself for that. And my friend replied equally sarcastically, "Father Ed, you are the model of the sacrificial life. Teach us your ways." But it's not like that. It's really giving up something important. The famous Anglican priest, John Wesley, wrote this very serious prayer of self-dedication. He wrote, "Lord, I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Rank me with whom you will. Let me be employed by you or laid aside for you, exalted for you or brought low for you. Let me have all things or let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. Amen." You see, the things that has empowered serious Christians like John Wesley throughout the centuries to take up their crosses, contrary to popular belief, is not our love for Jesus, but rather Jesus' love for us. What has empowered the martyrs throughout history to face suffering and death is the realization that God's love is more powerful and more important than all the hatred the universe can muster. So let us take up our crosses then, not as something we're saddled with, but something we choose to do. Whether it's volunteering for a literacy program or housing the homeless or visiting the sick, if we can get in, or comforting those who mourn, or feeding the hungry, or teaching a class, or volunteering to be an adult acolyte behind me, or even singing in the virtual choir that nobody can see. Our crosses are what we choose to take up. Let us search until we find the cross that God has waiting for us, and then take them up, not because they're thrust upon us, but simply because it's the only appropriate response to the costly grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. For we still live in Caesarea Philippi. We still live in a world where people worship anything and everything, worlds that are full of temples to pagan deities, except we call them by other names now, Lamborghini, or Ferrari, or Givenchy, or Oscar de la Renta, or Armani, or money, or power, or sex, the latest and greatest smartphone, whatever it is that people want so badly that they're willing to do just about anything to get it. Our city is full of skyscraper temples, like Caesarea Philippi, except they're built to the glory of hotels and banks. For the thing we focus on and obsess about are still the answer to Jesus' question in the midst of this focus on human acquisition: who do you say that I am? And we answer that question more with what we do with our lives rather than with our words. So think, what is it I want so bad? What is my idol? As William Cowper wrote, "The dearest idol I have known, whate'er that idol may be, help me to tear it from my throne and worship only thee." So our homework this Lenten week is to figure out, what is that idol that I hold dearest in the world, and pray to God to help me take it off of Jesus' throne. Because you know what? On Jesus' throne, there's only room for one, and that one is Jesus.